Thank you. Good morning to everybody. This instruction course is basically based on pterygium and titled A to Z of Pterygium Management. As you all know, pterygium is derived from the Greek word pterygion, meaning small wing. It is a slow-growing, wing-shaped, fibrovascular growth of bulbar conjunctiva, encroaching upon cornea, usually from nasal part of the limbus within the internal part of the aperture. A fully developed pterygium contains three parts: head, the triangular apex of the pterygium over the cornea; body, the main mass of the growth over the sclera; and the neck, that is junction of head and body at the limbus. It is more common in males. Male-female ratio is 2:1. Usually seen between 30 to 50 years of age, uncommon before 20 years. Mostly outdoor workers are the sufferers who are exposed to bright sunlight, dry and dusty environment. As far as etiopathogenesis is concerned, the exact etiopathogenesis of pterygium is still not understood. However, various theories have been proposed regarding its etiology, and the most of the common etiological factor is exposure to ultraviolet radiation, which is supposed to be a major risk factor. Ultraviolet exposure may induce hyperplasia in limbar cells. These altered cells invade the cornea and limbus, which move centripetally with them. This explains wing shape of the pterygium. Immunologically, cell-bound IgE irritant complexes initiate the release of inflammatory mediators from mast cells, which further lead to release of stimulatory factors and development of pterygium. It is also one of the risk factors. Genetic factors is also concerned in the development of pterygium, which is expression of imantane. P53 mutation leads to decreased apoptosis and increased TGF-beta, which leads to increased growth. Increase in non-profusion area and attenuated vessels in nasal limbus during early stage of pterygium causes recruitment of progenitor cells. Infection with herpes simplex virus and human papilloma virus have been suspected as risk factor. These days, angiogenic growth factors have been considered to be one of the most important factors in the etiopathogenesis of pterygium. Increased level of pro-angiogenic factors may contribute to the progression of pterygium by means of angiogenesis. As far as pathology is concerned, pterygium is a degenerative condition of subconjunctival tissue, which undergoes elastotic degeneration and proliferates as vascular growth tissue overlying the epithelium. It ultimately encroaches the cornea, destroying the corneal epithelium, stroma, and the Bowman's membrane. Histologically, it can be classified as angiomatous when stroma contains a significant number of vascular vessels, fibrous, where stroma is predominantly fibrous with a few scattered vascular elements, and the mixed, when stroma contains both vascular elements and thin bundle of collagen tissue. Clinically, it can be progressive or atrophic. Progressive pterygium is thick, fleshy, pink or reddish looking vascular growth, which is progressive in nature, while atrophic pterygium is thin, papery, dry, pale looking growth, which usually remains stationary. Location wise, it can be nasal, temporal or double pterygium. Nasal pterygium is those which is found on nasal side of the limbus. Temporal pterygium found on temporal side of the limbus, while double pterygium can occur on both sides of the limbus. Pterygium can also be divided into different stages. In stage 0, the lesion is posterior to limbus, while in stage 1, lesion involves the limbus. In lesion stage 2, lesion appears just on the limbus, when vascularity is normal but a minimal elevation is observed on conjunctival and corneal tissue. In stage 3, lesion covers the area between limbus and papillary margin. There is moderate vascularity with vessel congestion. And stage 4, lesion is central to the papillary margin. This is a severe form of pterygium with vessel congestion and dilatation. As far as symptoms of ectrasia is concerned, patient may have redness, warm body sensation, chronic irritation, dryness of the eye, lacrimation, restricted movement of the eye resulting in diplopia. Other symptoms may be cosmetic disfigurement, problem in fitting contact lens, reduced visual acuity. When examined, ectrasia is a small fleshy mass of conjunctiva, usually drawn from medial canthus and growing towards the limbus. We can see triangular encroachment of growth onto the cornea. In front of the advancing edge of ectrasia, sometimes there is a line of infiltration indicating the progression of lesion. A pigment line called Stoker's line may be seen in central corneal epithelium ahead of the ectrasia, which is due to deposition of iron pigment on the Bowman's membrane. It can be differentiated from pseudoterygia, which can occur anywhere around the limbus, which occurs mostly due to some inflammatory condition of cornea and conjunctiva. Pseudoterygia fixed only at its effects to the cornea and not firmly and closely adherent to the underlying structure. A probe can be passed beneath its neck, which differentiated from pseudoterygia. Other differentiating condition may be OSSN. Ectrasia produces few complications in the form of reduced visual acuity due to reduced astigmatism or encroachment of pupillary area of cornea, disruption of precorneal tear film. There may be diplopia due to restricted eye movement, and it may inflame intermittently. Now, when we should consider treatment, the indication for treatment are for the cosmetic purpose, when vision is threatened, induced astigmatism, contact lens intolerance prior to cataract surgery, and before planning for refractive surgery. Treatment is essentially surgical. When medical management is concerned, you can give tear substitute. We can use mild corticosteroid NSAIDs in the case of inflammation for symptomatic relief. But the best is prevention of ectrasia from the sunlight. So you protect yourself from outdoor worker from sunlight by wearing sunglasses, cap or hat, or we may educate the workers to have away from this exposure of ultraviolet rays. Surgically, excision of bare sclera technique is the most common employed method, but it is not advocated due to its high recurrence rate, which is in the form incidence of 30 to 90%. Recurrence of ectrasia is a major problem in case of bare sclera technique. A number of factors have been reported for the recurrence of primary ectrasia. One of the factors responsible for recurrence is postoperative conjunctiva inflammation and fibrovascular growth. It has been reported that persistent conjunctival inflammation around the surgical site after the surgery is present in about 15% cases of conjunctival autograft. Increased level of growth factor, especially vascular endothelial growth factor, which is known to be produced in response to several stimuli, including ultraviolet radiation. So, what should we adopt the strategy for prevention of this recurrence of pterygium? As you all know, recurrent pterygium is more difficult to manage due to thinning of underlying cornea and extensive scarring. Considering the different factors responsible for recurrence, various treatment modules have been adopted, which can be change in surgical technique and use of adjuvant therapy. The adjuvant therapy may be in the form of application of beta radiation, argon radiation, argon laser application. There may be chemotherapy. We may apply theotepa, steroids, mitomycin C, 5-fluorouracil, cyclosporin A, anti-VEGF, doxycycline, so on. And the change in surgical technique in the form of lambda-cleotoplasty, amniotic membrane transplantation, conjunctival flap. We may do conjunctival autograft, conjunctival rotation graft, and the cultivated conjunctival transplantation. This ICE present certain guidelines and highlight particular treatment strategy for the prevention of pterygium recurrence. It is designed to be relevant, scientific, and practical. My other co-instructors are Dr. Sunil Kumar, Associate Professor, Regional Institute of Ophthalmology, RIMS Ranchi, who will deal on surgical management of pterygium, part one, that is conjunctival autograft. Then Dr. M. Siraj Ali, a glaucoma consultant and senior ophthalmologist of Ranchi, who will deal on surgical management of pterygium. Then Dr. Jahid Ali Siddiqui, the renowned ophthalmologist and cornea specialist from Bokaro, Jharkhand, who will deal on surgical management of recurrent pterygium. Is it different? Unfortunately, Dr. Suya Samanta is not present. So the topic of Suya Samanta, that is post-operative management in pterygium surgery, will be taken up by Dr. Sunil. So now I pass this to Dr. Sunil for his presentation. Dr. Sunil, please. Dr. Sunil, can you hear me? You start your presentation.
Yes, good morning, everyone.
We are not audible, Dr. Sunil.
I am just sharing my screen. Is my slide visible?
No.
Not yet. But the screen sharing has started.
So please unshare your screen and then again share the screen.
Okay, I will do that. It is visible now?
Not now, not sir.
I have not shared it. Okay, I will share again.
In the meantime, I can do my presentation.
Yes.
It's come now.
Now it is. Okay. Thank you. Okay. Thank you. So good morning, everyone. So first of all, I would like to thank Professor Dr. Rajiv Gupta.
Please put on the full screen mode.
Okay. I'm doing it.
Yes, thank you.
So first of all, I would like to thank Professor Dr. Rajiv Gupta for giving me this opportunity to be the part of this very useful instruction course. So
unmute yourself, Dr. Sunil.
Sir, you have to unmute yourself. You're on mute.
Dr. Sunil, audio is not coming.
No, it is showing that you are unmuted by the host. Very technical person?
No. Carry on, please.
Now I am audible?
Yes.
Okay. So I have no any financial interest in any of this product and technical medicine. So when the surgical management is indicated, it may be indicated in when the patient is very much symptomatic, like patient had recurrent irritation, redness or watering. It is also indicated in cases of if it is affecting the visual problem, like if the pterygium is encroaching the visual axis, patient may have the decreased vision, or if the pterygium is causing astigmatism, it is mainly causing the irregular astigmatism. So again, patient will have the visual problems. Another is the cosmetic indication. This is the most common indication for the pterygium surgery. And sometimes we do the pterygium surgery for therapeutic purposes also. Like if the patient has the problem in wearing the contact lenses, or in cases of the before the corneal refractive surgery. If the patient is planned for the some LASIK surgery or other, we have to do the pterygium surgery first. And also the cataract surgery, it is very important to do the pterygium surgery first, so that we can have the exact keratometry value after the removal of the pterygium. So the pterygium excision. So removal of the pterygium involves the surgical excision of the head, neck, as well as the body of the pterygium. The body and base of the pterygium are first dissected with the conjunctival scissor, while the head and neck of the pterygium that has invaded the cornea is often removed with a surgical blade. So an attempt is made to identify the plane of dissection, which facilitates the removal of the pterygium while keeping the underlying corneal surface smooth. Also, the remnant stromal attachments may be smoothed out with the help of the blade, or motorized burr can also be used. So, bare aspiration. If there are no additional measures are performed after pterygium excision, we commonly call it as bare aspiration. This was practiced in the past, but it has high recurrence rate, which may range from the 30 to 80%, even 90%. As such, the bare aspirate excision alone is no longer recommended nowadays for the treatment of the pterygium. So what we can do to prevent the pterygium recurrence? So pterygium excision is often combined with various adjunctive measures to prevent the recurrence of the disease. It can be as medical methods like use of mitomycin C. It can be the use of the beta irradiation, or various surgical methods has also been applied to decrease the rate of the recurrence. So what are different surgical methods which are possible in these cases? The surgical options include, the number one is the conjunctival autograft. It could be the limbal and limbal conjunctival transplant, conjunctival sliding flap, conjunctival rotational autograft, in which the conjunctiva or the pterygium itself is used and it is rotated. We can use the amniotic membrane or amniotic membrane transplant, or cultivated conjunctival transplant can also be used, and the lamellar keratoplasty. So I will be mainly dealing with the conjunctival autograft. So the pterygium excision with conjunctival autograft, this is the procedure of the choice nowadays for the treatment of primary as well as the recurrent pterygium, because of its efficacy as well as the long-term safety. So in this, a free conjunctival graft is harvested from the superior bulbar conjunctiva and is secured in place over the bare ascleral defect. So we can see in this photograph, this is the case of the primary pterygium, the upper photographs, and we have the harvested the conjunctival graft from the superior bulbar conjunctiva, and it is secured over the bare ascleral defect with the help of the sutures. So why conjunctival autograft is necessary? Because it is at the lowest rate of recurrence. It could be as low as 2%. It has minimal side effects and complications. It is very much cost effective because patient own conjunctiva is required. And it has better post-operative comfort and better post-operative cosmesis as well. So what is an ideal conjunctival autograft? If we are planning the conjunctival autograft, we have to see that it should be as thin as possible. Also, the conjunctival graft should be completely devoid of the tenon capsules. There should not be buttonholing, so we have to carefully dissect the conjunctival graft. Also, the size and shape of the conjunctival graft should be same as the bare ascleral defect. Also, the orientation of the graft is very important. The limbal side of the graft should be towards the limbal side of the bare ascleral defect, also the epithelial side of the graft should be toward the surface and the stromal side toward the bare scleroderma factor. So first the harvesting of the conjunctival graft. We first measure the area of the resection, that is the bare sclera, pull the eye downwards, and we use the some markers, either marker pen or Jensen palette can be used. We also give the central mark, we have to in the orientations. We inject subconjunctival 2% xylocaine with adrenaline with the help of 26 gauze needle to separate the conjunctiva from the tenon capsule, and we carefully dissect the conjunctiva with the conjunctival scissor or Varner scissor. And we make sure that the graft is very thin as possible, and we have to avoid the button marks. So this is the photograph just showing the, this is the scleral defect, and we measure the bare scleral defect in the both the dimensions, the radial as well as the horizontal dimension. And then we mark the over the superior conjunctiva, and also we mark the central portion of it, so that we can have the better orientations. Now again in alignment in some detail, we select the conjunctival graft on the cornea and then into the scleral defect, with the care that limbal side of the graft remains toward the limbal side of the bare scleral defect. Also care should be taken that epithelial side of the graft remains toward the surface and the stromal side toward the bare scleral defect. Now how to secure the conjunctival graft over the bare scleral defect? We can use either a 10-0 nylon suture or 10-0 vicryl suture. We can also use the fibrin glue, in which we have to apply the fibrin glue. And sometimes we can use only the patient's own blood, autologous blood, which is oozing from the defect to secure this graft. Now coming to the suturing of the graft. We secure the all four corners of the graft with the episcleral bite. We should avoid the medial rectus area to minimize the bleedings. We close the nasal conjunctiva to the conjunctiva of the graft. Here no episcleral scleral bite is taken. We also close the edge to edge superiorly as well as inferiorly. And we have to make sure that there is no any exposed tenon capsule, otherwise granuloma formation can occur. And we also avoid the running sutures. Now bandage contact lens is applied at the end of the procedure. It gives the comfort to the patients. We can also be without the patches, and we can left this BCL for the 2 weeks. It also decreases the chance of delayed formations. Now this is a small video clip showing the conjunctival graft with suturing. So it is a case of the primary pterygium. And after the resection of the pterygium excision, we are marking the scleral area for the taking the conjunctival graft. And we are dissecting this graft as thin as possible. This is then slided over the cornea, and this is a cut with the limbus. Now it is placed over the bare scleral defect, and it is being sutured with the 10-0 knuckle. So now it is sutured all around with the 10-0 knuckle. You can see that all the scleral defect area is covered with a graft. This is another video clip showing this conjunctival autograft where we have used the fibrin glue. So again, it is a case of primary pterygium, and we are dissecting this excised pterygium, and after this, we are again making the marking over the superior conjunctiva. We are injecting subconjunctival xylocaine to separate the conjunctiva from the tenons, and we then very carefully separate this graft. And it is cut at the limbus. And now the components of the fibrin glue is applied first on the bare scleral defect and then over the stromal side of this graft, which is harvested from the superior conjunctiva. Then it is placed over the bare scleral defect, and then the graft is spread evenly so that it covers the whole bare scleral area. So you can see that the graft is nicely placed over the bare scleral defects. So these are post-op on the follow-up in the above slides, above pictures. We can see that we have used these conjunctival graph with the permanent glue, and at the 1 year follow-up, we can see this graph at very good cosmesis. In the below, we have used the conjunctival angular nylon sutures, and this again 1 year follow-up, showing the very good cosmesis without any recurrence. But conjunctival graph can also have some complications, like recurrence of its edge can also occur, although the rate is very low. There can be the graft edema or graft inflammation. Infections very rarely can occur. Sometimes bleeding under the graft occurs. Dental formations can occur, or the granuloma formations, if the we left the phenon capsule exposed, there can be the chances of the granuloma. These are some photographs of this complication, like we can see the graft inflammation with edema, graft necrosis, dental formations, or the recurrence of the tendons. So to conclude, the pterygium excision with conjunctival autograft is the procedure of the choice for the primary as well as the recurrent pterygium. Ideally, the graft should be thin and devoid of the phenon capsule. It should be of the same size and shape as of the aspirate defect, and it should be aligned properly. Also, the graft should be secured well in the aspirate bed with the suture or permanent glue or autologous bed edge-wise. Thank you very much for kind listening.
Thank you, Dr. Sunil, for your nice presentation.
Okay, thank you.
Now I invite Dr. Siraj for his presentation. Dr. Siraj, please.
Can I ask some question, Dr. Sunil?
Yes, please.
If sir allows, then only.
Yes.
One
yes.
is then, sir, whenever we have a pterygium with a cataract, so
yes.
whether to go for a separate time surgery for pterygium, then cataract, or go for the simultaneous?
No, it is better to do first pterygium surgery at least 3 months before the cataract, so that we can have the exact keratometry value. Otherwise, the IOL power calculation can be different. Especially if you are planning the premium IOL or toric IOL. Then the pterygium must be excised before, at least 3 months before the surgery. What do you have to do?
But sometimes patient comes with the intumescent cataract and he has a pterygium. What to do in that situation? Three months is sometimes is a larger gap.
You can combine the both procedure also, but you have to take care of the keratometry reading. Otherwise, you can do the intraoperative keratometry also can be done. What do you prefer, Jasmine?
We keep a gap of 1 month. 1 month.
Yeah. That's also good, 1 month.
Okay, fine. Thank you. Dr. Siraj, go ahead, please.
The slide visible?
Yes.
Yes, sir.
Okay. A very good afternoon to all of you. At the outset, I would like to thank Dr. Partha Biswas sir, Chairman Scientific Committee, AIOS, and Dr. Rajesh Gupta sir for giving me an opportunity to be part of this instruction course. The first report of a surgical treatment of pterygium is more than 3,000 years old. And over the years, a myriad of surgical techniques have been devised to tackle the pterygium, but none has achieved a complete success in efficacy and safety. The technique of bare stereo excision alone has largely been abandoned because of its unacceptably high recurrence rates. The high recurrence rates associated with pterygium surgery continue to be a problem, and thus adjunctive therapies have been incorporated into the management of pterygium. And studies have shown that recurrence rates have dropped considerably with the addition of these therapies. The bare scleral technique had been modified in an attempt to reduce the recurrence rate. The modified bare scleral technique was based on the understanding of the important role of normal conjunctiva in blocking pterygium regrowth on the corneal surface. However, none of these modifications were able to achieve acceptable recurrence rates in the long term. Both these studies described a new technique in which a thin layer of conjunctival graft was fashioned from the pterygium tissue. In this study by Sanjay Chaudhary et al., the graft was rotated by 180 degrees. The investigators thought that by rotating the graft in such a way that the disease epithelium at a limbal end was shifted away to prevent recurrence. In the other study by Kodavur et al., the graft was not rotated. Here, the investigators believe that limbus to limbus orientation might not be necessarily maintained to avoid recurrence, and the graft should be adequate enough to cover the bare steroid defect irrespective of its orientation. In this technique, a narrow 2 mm wide free conjunctival epithelial autograft was fashioned from the superior bulbar conjunctiva. A 1 to 2 mm zone of undisturbed conjunctiva was preserved posterior to the limbus to ensure that the limbal stem cells were not violated. The graft and the residual conjunctival margin were sutured in a way that allowed a 2 to 3 mm zone of bare sclera between the two. Here, the investigators believe that this approach provides for wider adjacent conjunctival margins for preservation of limbal stem cells on one side and avoidance of incursion into the superior fornix and superior rectus insertion on the other side. In this innovative technique, an amniotic membrane graft was placed on the bare sclera. A crescent blade was then used to create a 2x2 mm strip of limbal tissue by dissecting from the conjunctival side into the cornea. This limbal tissue was then cut into 8 to 10 smaller pieces with Vanas scissors, and then these pieces were glued along the conjunctival side of the limbus over the previously fixed amniotic membrane. These limbal tissue pieces were again protected with a smaller glued amniotic membrane overlay. The investigators argued that the addition of these stem cells could reduce recurrence rate and as a result improve the cosmetic outcome. In the study from China, Ologen was placed under the conjunctival flap, leaving a 2 mm wide area of bare sclera at the limbus. In this study, Ologen was used as a spacer to mechanically separate the subconjunctival tissue and the episcleral tissue to prevent fibrosis. However, the study concluded that there was no statistically significant difference between the Ologen group and the conjunctival autograft group with respect to pterygium recurrence. Many studies have documented that it is the friction between the eyelids and the corneal and the conjunctival wounds that could stimulate the healing process and could also cause wound dehiscence, which may increase the risk of recurrence. In this study, to reduce the friction-induced inflammation, the investigators protected the conjunctival autograft with an amniotic membrane overlay. In addition, they also used contact lens to cover the cornea and the conjunctiva during the initial early post-operative period. In this Cochrane systematic review of 20 randomized controlled trials in which a total of 1947 eyes of 1866 participants were analyzed, the reviewers compared the effects of conjunctival autograft relative to amniotic membrane transplantation with respect to pterygium recurrence at 3 and 6 months after surgery. The 3 months recurrence rates were similar for both groups based on data from 538 eyes in 6 RCTs. And pterygium recurrence rate 6 months after the surgery were much lower in the conjunctival autograft group than in the amniotic membrane transplant group based on data from 1,021 eyes in 10 RCTs. A split graft can be used to cover large conjunctival defects created in double head pterygium. Multi-recurrent pterygium is complicated due to the exaggerated proliferative tendency represented by active fibroplasia, wound contraction, and angiogenic sprouting. Two main perioperative strategies are essential to relax the exaggerated hyperproliferation. The first is to minimize the postoperative inflammation, which may prolong proliferation and angiogenesis. The second is to maximize the ablation of residual fibroblasts in the surgical wound area. For the management of multi-recurrent complicated pterygium, different types of modalities of treatment have been tried and used, but it is the combination of approaches that works best in such cases. Over the last 25 years, Professor Lawrence Hurst from Australia has developed a surgical procedure known as PERFECT, which is the short form of pterygium extended removal followed by extended conjunctival transplant. This technique has reduced the recurrence rates from 10% to 15%, usually described in the literature to 0.1%, along with excellent cosmetic results. The procedure is done in 3 logical steps. First, pterygium and extensive tenon removal. Second, retrieval of a very large and very thin graft. And finally, the reconstruction of the pterygium site. This study reports the largest single prospective series of recurrent pterygium removal with a 1-year minimum follow-up in the scientific literature. With a 0 recurrence rate and excellent cosmetic results, Professor Hurst claims that Perfect surgery for pterygium seems to provide the best surgical answer for recurrent pterygia. This is another paper by Professor Hurst, which was published in the Journal of Ophthalmology in 2012. Here also, Professor Hurst reported a very low recurrence rate, a good cosmetic appearance, and an acceptable complication rate with the perfect technique. Laminar keratoplasty has been used to replace the thinning and the corneal scarring seen after pterygium surgery. The main limitations are the need for donor corneal tissue with the attendant risks of graft rejection and transmission of an infection, as well as the increased complexity of the procedure. However, laminar keratoplasty does not appear to provide any special advantage in preventing the pterygium recurrence. The combination of conjunctival autografting and amniotic membrane grafting has been used in recurrent pterygium with restriction of movements. In these cases, amniotic membrane is used to cover the muscle to prevent fibrosis and restriction of movements, while the conjunctival autograft is used to close the defect from the pterygium tissue. This is relatively an old case report of three patients who had repeated pterygium surgery and who eventually had split thickness buccal mucosal membrane grafting combined with beta irradiation with good results. In this prospective clinical trial from South Korea, the investigators performed pterygium excision with intraoperative insertion of multi-microporous expanded polytetrafluoroethylene sheet into the subconjunctival space at the nasal caruncle. Multiple micropores were created in the sheet to enable the passage of oxygen from the air to the surgical wound in order to prevent hypoxia-induced scar formation during the initial proliferative phase of wound healing. In this study, the multi-microporous expanded polytetrafluoroethylene sheet insertion technique combined with conventional surgical methods showed a 3.3% recurrence rate. Dr. Shepard and his team came up with this table and suggested that the surgical procedure selected depends primarily on the clinical presentation and the complexity of the pterygium. So what the future holds in store for us in pterygium surgery? This study, quite a recent one, reports the outcomes of the first clinical trial on the use of femtosecond laser to prepare conjunctival autograft in pterygium surgery and to compare the outcomes with those of manual technique. Studies have shown that achieving an ultra-thin conjunctival autograft requires a considerable surgical skill and is associated with a substantial learning curve. Approximately 50 attempts were required for a trainee to achieve a conjunctival autograft thickness of 87 microns. The femtosecond laser technique may be valuable in overcoming the learning curve. It also allows reliable, accurate, and consistent ultra-thin conjunctival autograft preparation. This study was also associated with low complication rate, low recurrence rate, minimal discomfort, good cosmetic appearance, and comparable surgical time, as well as visual and refractive outcomes with conventional manual technique. Radiofrequency, also known as radiosurgery, is a non-traumatic method of cutting and coagulating soft tissues using a high-frequency electric current. In this study, a radiofrequency unit was used to harvest conjunctival autografts. After a follow-up of at least 12 months, the incidence of recurrence was less than 5%. Extracellular matrix serves as a scaffold on which new conjunctival growth can be constructed and facilitates anatomical and functional reconstruction to reduce pterygium recurrence. Use of extracellular matrix offers several advantages and is most suitable for patients with a limited conjunctival reserve or those that may undergo a future glaucoma surgery. In an alternative approach to increasing precision, Boschetti and his team investigated the use of robot-assisted pterygium surgery in a porcine model and recently in a patient. While they found the procedure to be feasible and no complications occurred, the surgery time still limits its application in routine clinical cases. In particular, the conjunctival autograft preparation time in the porcine model took substantially longer time than femtosecond laser-assisted grafts or manual dissection. So finally, to take my take-home message, direct comparison among studies remain difficult because of the differences in the technique of pterygium excision, duration, and types of adjuvant therapies used. Regarding pterygium excision, there is presently no agreement on the best method of excision. Excision alone without adjuvant treatment is now no longer acceptable. It is accepted that various adjuvant therapies and the combinations have significantly improved the treatment outcome in terms of recurrence, cosmetics, and patient satisfaction. Many surgeons believe that using mitomycin C and conjunctival autograft technique provides the most satisfactory results. Of these two, conjunctival autograft is preferred because of the long-term safety concerns. Thank you for your kind listening.
Thank you, Dr. Siraj, for a beautiful well deliberated presentation. Delegates will know the newer techniques of the treasure management, recurrent, how to do away with the recurrence of treasure. So the next presenter in this IC course is Dr. Jahid, well-known cornea specialist. Dr. Jahid, we start your presentation.
Thank you, sir. Is it visible?
Yes.
Yes. Thank you, Dr. Gupta, sir, and AIUS for letting us present in AIUS this time also. And I like to thank Dr. Siraj also, because most of the recurrent pterygium part he has already covered in the more detail than I am going to cover. But still, I have to do my job, and we'll start from here. This is the recurrent pterygium. This is how it looks like. And the recurrent pterygium, by definition, is a fibrovascular tissue across the limbus onto the cornea after the primary removal of the primary pterygium. Histopathologically, primary pterygium is an elastotic degeneration, but the recurrent pterygium differ to it. It is a fibrovascular proliferation. It is created by conjunctival epithelial defect, which leads to the development of fibrovascular proliferation, eventually leads to the recurrence of pterygium. The cause of the recurrent pterygium is multifactorial. Age less than 40 years is one of them. And the morphology of the primary pterygium, more the fleshier the primary pterygium, there are more chances of recurrence in those cases. And the iatrogenic, like what the technique was used for the surgery, like Bayer sclera has a more chances of recurrence. And the other surgeries like autograft, already been discussed, has a lower chances of recurrence. And so grading of recurrent pterygium was proposed by Seng et al. It was depending on the normal appearance of fibrovascular tissue and the morphology of carunculus and the presence or absence of diplopia in those patients. The pathogenesis of recurrence, as I was saying, it is whenever you do Bayer sclera technique, there is a gap between tenon and conjunctival tissue forms. And this gap leads to the proliferation of fibrovascular proliferation and leading to the recurrence. Recurrence rate can be as high as like 90% in the Bayer sclera technique, or lower in the cases of different adjuvant therapies. There are two charts. One is published by M. Fernandez. They have shown that in their own study of 14 years, the recurrence rate was around 12% in the conjunctival autograft and 26% in amniotic membrane grafting. And if they have included limbal cells in the conjunctival graft, the recurrence was around 17% to 18%, and Bayer sclera has 19%. More say they have almost similar kind of recurrence in all, except they have a little higher recurrence in with the amniotic membrane grafting. But in Donald Tan, they have compiled all the studies available, and they found that the Bayer sclera alone has 24% to 89% of the recurrence. And if you add mitomycin C with the Bayer sclera technique, it goes up to 0% to 38% of the recurrence. And conjunctival autograft was similarly around 2% to 39% of recurrence after primary surgery. Surgical management includes like anti-metabolites, 5-fluoroacil, mitomycin C, and recently anti-VEGF like bevacizumab has been tried in the treatment. And then the conjunctival limbal autograft, amniotic membrane, mini slit, and the perfect technique was discussed by Dr. Siraj. And as he was rightly saying, that no one surgery can reduce the recurrence. There has to be adjuvant therapy for the treatment. Alone, you can't do. So why this surgical treatment is different? Because there is a subconjunctival fibrous tissue in abundance, and they are very tightly adherent to the underlying sclera and cornea. Whenever we do primary surgery in the pterygium, we just hold the head of the pterygium and evolves it like a capsular rexis or pterygium rexis. But it is not possible in the recurrent pterygium cases. You usually can't evolve it from the cornea easily. There you have to do a fine dissection. And histopathologically have shown that in a primary pterygium, the invasion of conjunctival tissue not goes beyond the Bowman's layer. But in the recurrent pterygium, it goes up to the deeper stroma. So many times you have to shave off superficial stroma along with your dissection. So now come the studies of, this is the randomized controlled trial. It was published in a Cornea Journal in 2012. They did a randomized controlled trial of bevacizumab in the 80 patients, and they divided this patient in a four group, 20 patients each randomly. And the first group was served as a control, and the second group was given subconjunctival injection 1.25 milligram of bevacizumab, and second was given 2.5 milligram, and third group was given 3.75 milligram. And on the follow-up, bevacizumab group had lower hyperemia, decreased congestion in the conjunctiva, but this treatment was not, it doesn't cause any regression or reduction in the rate of recurrence of impending recurrent pterygium. So actually it is useless. And the second metabolite is 5-fluorouracil, which was used in intralesional in a 2 to 5 milligram doses. And this is in a, this group was, this study was published by H.S. Dua group in a Royal College of Journal, Royal College of Ophthalmology Journal. And they given 2.5 to 5 milligram 5-fluorouracil injection in the dome of advancing pterygium. They are all impending recurrence pterygium. And 15 eyes were analyzed. They showed 93% cases show significant regression, but eventually in the long term, 3 patients went for the secondary excision of the pterygium, and they didn't absorb any significant side effect with the 5-fluorouracil, although they gave up to 8 injections on the weekly interval. In another study published by Kawai Kan, it was a randomized control trial with a conjunctival limbal autograft with a mitomycin sheath. It was a 15-year RCT where there are three group of patients, there are three type of treatment given. First group was given limbal conjunctival autograft alone. Second group was given mitomycin C alone. And third group was mitomycin C with conjunctival limbal autograft. Means the second group was a mitomycin C alone with a bare sclera, you can say. And 62 pair were included initially, but because due to long follow-up, only 40 patients were available for the final analysis. And they found only one recurrence in a limbal conjunctival autograft patient. And that even didn't require any surgical intervention. And they concluded the all three techniques yielded favorable outcome of the patient with a recurrent pterygium. But they say that limbal conjunctival autograft was associated with a better cosmetic outcome. Another study in a limbal where they compared the limbal conjunctival autograft with the AMG, and both were received the mitomycin C perioperatively. 96 eyes of recurrent pterygium were followed for the 12 months, and the corneal recurrence was present in only one case of conjunctival limbal autograft group and 5 cases of amniotic membrane group. Similarly, 60 cases of recurrent pterygium were analyze. Again, this is also AMT plus MMC, the similar intervention. Here was the recurrence was more in a mitomycin C group with the conjunctival autograft, and it was less in a amniotic membrane due to mitomycin C group. But that was statistically not significant. So overall, you can say the amniotic membrane or conjunctival limbal autograft along with the mitomycin C has a similar outcome in the both studies. Next is the transplantation of conjunctival limbal autograft and amniotic membrane versus mitomycin C and amniotic membrane treatment in a recurrent pterygium. It was published by M.R. Falah. So there were 20 questions in the both groups. They followed for 6 to 19 months. In AMG plus conjunctival limbal autograft group, there was a no recurrence. But the four cases of recurrence were found in amniotic membrane plus MMC group. So conjunctival limbal autograft, AMG seems to be more effective in intraoperative than intraoperative mitomycin C with amniotic membrane graft in the recurrent pterygium. And this is about the SLET, simple limbal epithelial transplantation plus tenectomy. With the mitomycin C and amniotic membrane transplant in the treatment of recurrent pterygium. They have total 10 cases, average recurrence around, average 2 recurrence plus minus 1.3. Result out of 10, showed only one recurrence, and that patient had already 5 recurrences before, and that even patient didn't require the second surgery. Means that didn't go for the 6th surgery. So overall, there is a different recurrent rate for the different type of pterygium surgery for the recurrence one. The bare sclera has 19 to 82.4% in the study is different, and amniotic membrane, it is around 9.5 to 52%. With alone conjunctival autograft, it's 0 to 33%. And if the amniotic membrane along with the mitomycin C, the recurrence decreases, it comes to 12 to 20%. And if we seal the gap between the conjunctiva and tenons, from where the proliferation starts for the recurrence, with the running suture, with AMT or conjunctival autograft or ocular or oral mucosa graft, the recurrence rate is 3.1. This was proposed by Seng and et al. Groups. So take home message is that whenever there is an impending pterygium, suppose we have operated a pterygium and after 1 month or 2 months, we see there is a recurrence started. At that time, intralesional 5-fluorouracil weekly is quite helpful. And for if there is already established corneal recurrence, then the pterygium excision along the anti-AMG plus CLAG is the mainstay of the recurrent pterygium surgery. But you have to keep something in mind. Whenever we are doing recurrent pterygium, don't dissect and recess. Never resect, because conjunctiva is already stretched and it causes shortening of conjunctiva. And the seal the gap between conjunctiva and tenon is the running suture to prevent the fibrovascular proliferation from that side. And here is the video. I didn't found myself a video for, so I have included Pradeep Mohanta's video from YouTube and the running commentary by Yudha Devan. It is quite nice and it was a quite learning experience for me. So I have included it. So please go through it. This video has the 3 times more speed to just go faster and see the dissection. It's just separating the conjunctiva from the underlying fibrovascular tissue with a blunt dissection. And now the under. Although there is a bleeding, he is not doing any cautery. Now he is dissecting out the fibrovascular tissue and excising it. And he's doing it without doing any cautery. Again, there is some more dissection on the other side. Dissecting the pterygium head from the cornea and removing all the fibrovascular tissue. Measuring for graft, I will skip that part. This is a very similar what Sunil has already shown. Without doing any cautery, just he is leaving behind the small specks of fresh blood on the bare area and is placing the conjunctival autograft over it. Honestly, in the recurrent pterygium, I always try to suture it. I don't rely on autologous serum or even fibrin glue. I love to suture it because the variscular is totally different from the primary pterygium. But here he is doing, he is a master and he is doing just without any glue. It is sweeping out any extra fluid from the under graft and it's done. Thank you so much. So I think next presentation over to Dr. Gupta sir.
Rajiv sir, please unmute yourself.
Hello.
Yes sir.
Thank you Dr. Jahir for your beautiful presentation. Now I invite Dr. Sunil Kumar for his final presentation. We will deal on post-operative management in pterygium surgery. Dr. Okay. Sunil.
Okay, is my screen visible?
Present.
My screen is visible?
Yes.
Yes. Okay. Just start slide.
Okay, so I will presenting the post-operative management of the pterygium surgery. I have no financial interest in any of the product or technique mentioned in this presentation. So what is the aim of the post-operative management in the pterygium surgery? First, to reduce the pain and discomfort of the surgery, to decrease the inflammation, promote re-epithelialization and prevent and treat any complication which occurs after the surgery, and also to reduce the chances of the recurrence. So therapeutic bandage soft contrast. It is applied at the end of the surgery. It accelerates the re-epithelialization. It also mitigates the pain and discomfort. And we can leave the bandage contact lens in place for at least 10 to 14 days. It should then be removed, but we can replace with another BCL if there are any remaining epithelial defects. Now topical drugs. What topical drugs we usually prescribe after the pterygium surgery? Topical antibiotics, we generally give for 2 weeks. Gatifloxacin 0.3% or moxifloxacin 0.5%. Also, we give the topical NSAIDs, topical steroids, lubricants, and cyclopregics. We will discuss in some detail about these drugs. So, topical NSAIDs. This is given to reduce the pain and inflammation of the surgery. We use the newer generation NSAIDs such as bromphenic or nepophenic. Bromphenic 2 times or nepophenic 3 times a day. But the topical NSAID drops should be used with some precautions. It should be avoided in older patients or neurotrophic cornea, patient with dry or if extensive cautery has been applied, or if there is a pre-existing scleral or peripheral corneal ectasia or exposed base scleral, because there can are chances of the scleral melt with the use of these NSAIDs. But it can be given in young patient with otherwise normal ocular surface. Now topical steroids. The topical steroids which generally we preferred are the lotiprenol, etavonate, 0.5%. And dosing schedule, what I generally preferred is the initial therapy with the topical lotiprenol up to 4 times a day. And also we give the lotiprenol ointment at bedtime for the 2 weeks. After 2 weeks, we reduce the dose of the drops to 2 times a day. And we continue this lotiprenol until the eye is completely quiet, all hemorrhages of bleeding has resolved, full comfort is restored, and all vasculature is returned to normal caliber. So this may require up to 3 months in routine cases, but in complicated or high recurrent cases, we can continue the steroids for longer periods. Next drops we prescribe generally are the lubricants. It promotes re-epithelialization and decreases the risk of the dermal formation, and also provides the comfort to the patient. We can use either CMC or SPMC, and it can be given 3 to 4 times a day for months. Cycloplegics rarely required. It is given in patients with very severe pain and photophobia, if the patient is some current sort of keratitis. Generally, cyclopentolate or homotropin prescribed, and it is given generally for the 1 or 2 weeks. Also, what are different strategies we can use for the pterygium recurrence in the post-op periods? If there is a high chance of the recurrence, we can give the topical steroid with increased frequency or potency. So the higher potent topical steroids such as dexamethasone or prednisolone acetate, we can use. Also, the oral doxycycline has been described in the literature, or topical azithromycin to prevent the pterygium recurrence. And it is not used for this antibiotic properties, but for the its anti-inflammatory and cholinergic property and some other immunomodulatory purpose. Also, the subconjunctival injection of the antifibrotic agents, such as and combination. This combination has been described in the literature, which consists of the steroid, either dexa or triamcinolone, plus 5-fluorouracil along with the lignocaine. And we can give this injection weekly to reduce the chances of the recurrence. Also, the subconjunctival injection of the anti-VEGF agents, such as bevacizumab, has been described also. Also, the treatment of the complications is important in the post-operative period. We have to carefully observe the different complications. So, graft inflammation edema is one of the first complications, and we give the high potency steroids such as dexa or prednisolone acetate 1%. And also, we can give the oral medication such as NSAID or steroids to reduce this graft inflammation. If the dead end formation occurs in the follow-up, we have to carefully follow up this patient, give the lubricants, preservative-free, and bandage contact lenses are prescribed. Graft necrosis, very rare complications. Topical steroids are given initially, and then we use the amniotic membrane transplant, or even the reconjunctival autograft from the other eye we can do. A scleral melt, although very rare, but it is sight-threatening complications, and generally associated with the use of the mitomycin C, Here we have to do the square patch graph or plus M dot E membrane graph. So just in short, the conclusion, the post-operative management is as important as surgical procedure, and the follow-up, a strict follow-up is required in this patient also. Individualized treatment protocol is needed depending on the type of the surgery used, done, and also the patient response to the surgery. A longer follow-up is required to prevent, recognize, and treat any complications if it occurs during the post-operative periods. So again, thank you.
Rajesh sir, please unmute yourself.
Hello, I am audible?
Yes, sir.
So, with this, we have finished our presentation in this instruction course. I want a comment from Dr. Jahid. Yesterday, I have seen a presentation where the author uses diathermy to fix the graft. So, what is your opinion of using diathermy in the fixation of the graft?
Yeah, that has a very good result actually. I have presented in last instruction course last year. I presented a couple of paper on that, and they showed that the patient is very comfortable because you don't have to suture that. And but I actually, after reading that article, even I went to try it also in my clinic, in my OT. But whatever lower setting I use, because we make graft very thin, so it was causing the shrinkage of the graft whenever you are applying on that. So I was not successful, but also there are a couple of reports and they have good result with that. The similar result as we find in autologous blood and with the fibrin glue.
Dr. Jayant, do you don't think that it excites more inflammation by using diathermy? And there may be damage to the underlying tissue.
They use very low power and only on the edges, on the four edges of the graft, four corners of the graft.
The main problem is the shrinkage of the graft. Shrinkage of the graft, if you inadvertently use the high power, there will be the shrinkage of the graft.
So I think whenever you are going for that, we need to fashion a larger graft, a little larger graft than what we are actually doing.
Yes.
I have one question to Dr. Sunil. So, what is your usual prescription for post-operative patient in a primary care region, sir? Usual prescription.
Usual presentation, one is the topical steroid. Generally, I prefer the topical loteprenolol etavonate, and one lubricant.
Okay.
One lubricant is there. And NSAID, generally, I don't prescribe. Only the one.
Okay, means antibiotic, a steroid, and a lubricant.
That's also generally applied in almost all the cases.
Have you ever gone for the anti-metabolite post-operatively injection?
No, I'm not.
Topically or whatever.
Yeah. No,
even I have not done that.
Yes.
And actually, nowadays, the recurrent pterygium is very less. Means when we went for this, we are going to do this presentation and I had to cover recurrent pterygium, I started looking for recurrent pterygium in my clinic. Yes. Means I have not seen a single one in last 4 or 5 months.
Yes.
So the incidence is so low nowadays for the recurrent pterygium
with
the use of
most of the surgeons now are using the conjunctival autograft. That
where
we are seeing this the recurrence nowadays.
Dr. Sunil, may I interrupt?
Yes, sir.
I am in agreement with Dr. Jahid that we are not seeing cases of recurrent pterygium since last few months. So, what may be the reason? I think combination of autograft, conjunctival autograft with application of mitomycin C, which is practiced by most of the surgeons,
I think this may be the reason for non-presentation
of recurrent pterygium.
Yes, sir. Previously, many of the surgeons were using this bare scleral technique. But now most of the surgeons are using this kind of autograft.
Dr. Siraj, will you add anything?
I just want to ask one question to Dr. Zahid. For recurrent pterygium, you also recommend using intralesional 5-fluorouracil also. So the dose is same with glaucoma surgery, or the dose differs, or you just dose is same only? Yeah?
So any other discussion left, Dr. Sunil?
No, sir.
Dr. Jahir, would you like to add anything on this, in this instruction course?
So even in the pterygium, recurrent pterygium, the preferred technique is still the conjunctival autograft, but we can add the mitomycin C in case of the recurrent pterygium.
Yes, most of these surgeons are now using the combination of autograft with mitomycin C in the primary excision.
But for primary pterygium, what I think is that conjunctival autograft alone is suffice. Mitomycin C is rarely required in cases of the primary pterygium. Generally, I don't prefer mitomycin C in primary pterygium.
And one thing more, I have seen 2 or 3 cases of scleral necrosis with the application of mitomycin C.
Yes,
there was melting of sclera. Yes. And it is very intractable disease and very difficult to overcome the condition.
Yes, it is one of the very side
complications. I have seen 2 or 3 cases.
Yes.
Actually, so, that is the reason I don't do mitomycin C. And Mr. Interregium, Mr. We use mitomycin C only in the trap cases.
Yes.
Not on the pterygium cases.
Because within traps also, complications are very, very common with mitomycin C.
Yeah.
Dr. Jayed, do you practice subconjunctival corticosteroid after finishing of the surgery?
No. No, sir. We are just giving, means once we close the, we just give antibiotic plus steroid ointment. Because we are patching for 24 hours. And so that ointment will help in controlling the inflammation in that period.
It becomes a problem when the patient is a steroid responder.
Yeah.
If already pre-diagnosed patient, so it becomes very difficult to manage these patients.
Exactly.
Yes. That's why we are using this
floating. Because it's a two-edged sword.
Yeah.
So, yeah,
so what do you do in those situations? Dr. Siraj.
Dr. Sunil, low dose steroid, low strength of steroid in the first operative period.
Yes, sir.
What do you use?
What
is your protocol, Dr. Jahir?
I use prednisolone acetate, sir, because initially I started using loteprednol, but very frequently I used to see graft edema when a patient comes for the 1 week visit. So again, I have to step up the steroid. So then I switch over to prednisolone. Now I start prednisolone 6 times a day of 1 week and then taper it down for over 4 weeks.
I agree with you. It is also my experience that in the post-operative period, prednisolone is more effective, I think. So.
Yes, it is more potent.
But no, it's obviously it's more
potent. More potent. So, anything left now? So, consensus of this instruction course is that we should use conjunctival autograft with application of mitomycin C. This is the consensus of this instruction course to prevent the recurrence. Thank you all the presentation on my behalf. Thank you, Dr. Partha Biswas, Chairman, Scientific Committee, for giving us the opportunity to present this IC course. I also thank the supporting staff, the technical staff of the AIS, who have marvelously done this job to air this instruction course. Thank you all of you. Thanks.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.